rolling. I don't think so. I shoot my guns at the house all the time. It's alright, mama. These are old ones. I don't think the mirror's loud if you look at the newer ones.
They never got the time, always got something else to do.
Yeah, true.
But this is so close, you know what I mean? It's like in town, it's like, hey, man, listen.
Theory, these guys should shoot.
All the decks out there, something.
Fire!
Boys out of here.
Back to that. Right now.
of trees.
Thank you.
No spoilers. No spoilers.
I can't get it.
I should have a couple at work. I took them vertical.
Yeah.
What do you know about the Battle of Front Royal?
So this is 1862, May 23rd.
May 23rd, 1862.
Now what I understand, you're Ken Thurman, wizardsofrealty.com, and you're a local community guy. So you do all this. But tell me, it was Stonewall Jackson had Southern Maryland troops, and there was a U.S. Maryland division, and this was the first time that literally brother against brother, fighting on opposite sides. It also was one of the first and only urban,
That's correct.
Loosely because, you know, a town, but actually, you know, normally it was in a big field somewhere.
Yes.
What else is significant about this Battle of Front Royal from 1862?
Well, when Belle Boyd reported to Jackson that the Maryland troops were in the town and that the town had been occupied, he actually stopped his troops coming up from Luray so that he could move his Maryland division forward so that they could have Maryland against Maryland. He also had a Louisiana shock troops that he had with him, and they came up forward also. And then they literally went through the town, house to house, street to street, all the way up to the north side of town, where Kenley tried to hold them at the river by putting a couple of what they called parrot cannons, which are big guns back in the day, up on Guard Hill. When the Confederate cavalry swept around him, he was forced to retreat up to Cedarville, where the battle ends. The Union actually claimed this as a victory, but it was obviously a victory for the South. From there, Jackson actually goes across Reliance Road, captures the supply wagons that are later brought down to the railway station here in 1862. And then when the Union looks like it's going to recapture the town, they burn the railway station to the ground, and it was rebuilt in 1885.
So really, this was a battle about making it harder for logistics for the... It wasn't really about a town of a couple thousand. Who cares? It was about...
No, it's the location of Front Royal. Front Royal, if you look at a geographic or topographical map, Front Royal has, at the top of the Massanutten Mountain chain, at the top of what's now the National Park, we have the river splitting just to the north of us. So you have the river traffic, and the river back in those days was a lot wider than it is today. So you had a lot of river traffic, rail traffic in and out of this area, in addition to natural pathways around the mountain ranges. And so this was of that type of strategic significance.
Was the river still a significant source of transportation at that time?
Yeah, back in those days, they did a lot of barge traffic up and down the river. It was much bigger and deeper than it is right now.
You know, the number of people that would have been involved in the actual battle, was it a big thing? Or?
No, not a really big thing. You've got probably a total of 3,000 troops altogether. Probably about 1,000 to 1,500 on each side.
Here or?
Here.
Okay.
So it's a small battle by battles, you know, of later days and then more.
You mean 3,000 people were on the streets of Front Royal fighting?
Yeah.
That would be like the population of the town.
The population of the town was close to 5,000 at that time, right in that time frame, 3,500 to 5,000. So, yeah.
Would there even be enough room, you know?
Now, it's the aftermath of battles that has always fascinated me. You know, you look at some of the bigger battles, like Gettysburg, and, well, who's mopping up after 50,000 people die on the battlefield?
Right.
Or Antietam, where 25,000 casualties in a single day.
Now, the people who actually lived or had businesses in these buildings, mm-hmm. First of all, what day of the week was it? What would those people have been doing?
Oh, gosh, I don't
were
know.
They
what
spectating
the,
or were they
I don't remember what May 23rd, 1862 was, day of the week.
See, I need one of those people on 60 Minutes that can just,
yeah, what
know,
was that day?
The lady from Cheers. So, mm-hmm. But like, with I know in the battles on the field, there would be people up on the hills, and mm-hmm. it was a spectator event.
Yeah, the Manassas was big for that. The first Manassas, they actually had horse and buggies and, you know, women out there watching the battle. And then when the Confederates pushed the Yankees back, it was kind of like, oopsie, where do we go? And
right.
So it was a mad rush to get back to town.
And they went building to building here.
Literally building to building. Now, it's a much smaller town than it is today, obviously. But yeah, it was house to house, building to building, all the way up to the north side of town and past the rivers.
Okay. All right, I'm going to try. Is Patrick Ferris around here? He's in charge of this whole thing.
He should be somewhere around here.
I'm going to try to interview Patrick Ferris, who is the head of the Warren Heritage Society, which is where we are. some of the oldest buildings in Front Royal are right here.
Yeah.
Front Royal is in northwestern Virginia, where 66 and 81 meet, right around there. Just a few. This here, I think, Ken, this was a kitchen building, right?
Yeah.
And I assume they had a separate building for the kitchens because they were afraid of starting a fire in the house, but apparently it was really gross, you know, to skin and gut a deer in your house. It stunk, so they did all that stuff outside here. I guess they're all getting along now, or they've surrendered, or what have you. This is the flag of Virginia, isn't it?
No, that's the
butterfly. Old meets new. You know if Patrick Ferris is in there?
Huh?
Is Patrick Ferris in there, you know? The head of the Heritage Society?
Oh, I haven't seen him for a while.
You folks are involved in this.
I am. I'm on the board of directors with him.
Oh, you're with the Heritage Society. Okay.
The last time I saw him, he was over there taking pictures, and I didn't see him come through here. He's a hard one to find.
I bet he's talking so much. How much more
red?
He's probably in the middle of a really interesting story.
Oh, I would imagine. Ah, you know him well.
Yes, I do. Okay, so. All right, let me go. I'm going to try to. There, is that him?
No.
No. Nope. That's Tim.
All right, I'm going to look around. You seen Patrick?
He's around the corner.
Awesome, thanks. All right, so we have a... There he is. This is the guy who knows everything. Literally.
And that was your intel.
He has the goatee. And he's with a guy who's apparently been operating on folks.
Yeah, he'll come into Ivy Lodge. Okay. And I'll send
two guys up to you.
All right, just be in that front room.
All right, you might have to wash my hands first.
Not at all. You go ahead and do that.
That's just the start, apparently.
Yeah, but
so what?
He's got plenty to do.
Can I talk to you real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
We've got
go
some
ahead.
Folks watching. Okay, so Patrick Ferris, you are the...
Executive Director of the Warren Heritage Society.
I know Patrick, but just for our viewers. You know.
Sorry. I just thought I'd spell it out in case you have to
right.
use that later.
Okay, so... I've already heard Ken Thurman and I kind of discuss what we had talked about earlier about the history of the Battle of Front Royal.
Right.
Tell me about the event today and why it's significant.
Well, the event today is significant because we've never done an attempt at a reenactment of the Battle of Front Royal. We have led battlefield tours on the day of the battle. We have done commemorative ceremonies. We've done exhibits. We've never done a reenactment of the battle. One of the reasons for that is obviously there are logistical issues which must be addressed. Unlike the Battle of Cedar Creek and the Battle of New Market, which took place for the most part out in fields, this battle took place in a town. So to reenact that battle, we have to use the town, its streets, its buildings, and for that we had to work with the police department and with the town of Front Royal. The town of Front Royal and the Front Royal PD were excellent to work with, I might say. So not only blocking the streets, but having a police presence to maintain safety and order, I think we had a wonderful event today for that reason. I also might stress that what we did today was a commemoration of the event. We try to avoid using the word celebration. Sometimes people say that in reference to the Civil War, but as people might have gotten an idea by watching this reenactment, the war was a horrible event. If you can imagine being a civilian in this town during that battle, not just the sights and sounds, but the idea that the bullets don't get stopped by houses. If you're in your home, you are not safe during a battle that takes place on your street. We really wanted to impart the feeling of that battle, and I think we accomplished that here today.
Let's get to that issue. What would have happened May 23rd, 1862? What time of the day was it? Do you know what day of the week it was?
Around noon.
Was it a weekday or
a
week?
Saturday.
A Saturday.
Yeah, it began, or I'm sorry, on Friday. It began. And when it began, the Confederate pickets lined up on the south end of town, on the hill overlooking the downtown. And when they swarmed, when they first came down, they came down to take over the courthouse and the Confederate hospital complex, mm-hmm. Both of which were being used by federal soldiers just to sleep in. And when those soldiers woke up to see Confederates lined up on the south end of town, they started firing at them from those buildings. So the battle actually began just about where we began the reenactment today, at the courthouse, because the first Maryland Confederate and the Louisiana Tigers were ordered by Jackson to rush in and take those buildings, and when they did, they were flushing out Union soldiers from the courthouse, and the fighting progressed from that point eastbound on Main Street and southbound on northbound on Chester, and that's exactly what happened today. So we repeated the battle in almost exactly the footsteps of the soldiers who fought it in 1862.
And this building is from 1788.
The Balthus House was built in 1788, so this house was standing exactly where it is standing now and looked remarkably like it does today.
So
when the battle took place.
The reason I say that is you said that those lead balls would have gone right through this thing.
This
is kind of a look at the construction.
Right, this is clapboard post and beam construction. However, inside the walls, we have this house is lined with brick on the bottom floor. That was done for insulation. So
okay.
If you were in a house like this, you might have a little bit more protection. However, bullets are still going to go through windows.
Right.
We do know from accounts of the battle and after the battle that as the battle began, and everybody could hear today how loud the gunshots are, there was nobody in town who did not know what was going on when it started. When the battle started, a lot of adults, mainly women, but a lot of adults, men and women, were grabbing children that they could find, whether they were their children or not, and throwing them down into root cellars, because that was the safest place to be. And then they would go down into the root cellars. So a lot of civilians did that. There was a teenage boy named Ashby who actually ran toward the sound of the guns. Had he been a soldier, that would have been proper behavior, but he was a kid. So he ran toward the sound of the guns and then found himself in horrible trouble. Because there were bullets flying around. He didn't know what to do. He crouched down behind a building, and a Confederate soldier grabbed him as the Confederates were moving through the town and threw him down next to a large tree and told him, "You stay there." And he wrote a memoir as an adult. That's how we know all of this. And he stayed there until the battle had moved past him. And then he eventually found his way home. His mother was none too happy with him because, of course, she hears the commotion of battle, she sees what's going on, and she doesn't know where her kid is. Of course, her kid is being a normal teenage boy and went out to watch the battle.
Right. As teenagers
so,
the battle's mortal.
The other thing to consider, of course, is the fact that the battle is excitement. The battle is noise, the battle is yelling and screaming and bullets flying. After the battle is a mess. The Union contingent guarding the town was about 1,100 men. Records show that about 21 at most got away. The majority of Union casualties are captured. There are wounded and there are killed, but the majority are captured, close to 800 men.
Where would they have been held?
They were held here. They
just
had to
like,
be
like,
marched back from
like
Cedar
your
Bowl.
House can take three
no,
of
they
them?
Were,
or, I mean,
they were taken down to the courthouse and held kind of in an open pen. The walking wounded and the unwounded were held
for how
down
long?
There. I'm sorry?
For how long would they have been
held? They were held there for a couple of days for processing. In addition, though, you had a lot of wounded, Union wounded and Confederate wounded. Wounded that could be transported, the Union wounded that could be transported, were sent with other Union prisoners south to Richmond, to Libby Prison. Union prisoners of war who were grievously wounded and could not be moved were kept in local homes, churches, and etc. So you had Union wounded that were left here for a long period of time. Confederate wounded, it was the same. You know, Confederate casualties were comparatively light, fewer than 100 men.
What about the guys who got injuries? There was no penicillin in 1862. What was the surviving, I mean, infection was the main killer, really, right?
It was. If you were shot in an extremity, if you were shot in your arm, your leg, your hand, or your foot, the usual treatment for that was amputation. unless the wound was a light wound. Even a light wound you could get an infection from. But if it was a grievous wound in an extremity, they just amputated it. They didn't take a chance. Even with amputation, you run the risk of infection, but less of a risk. The great risk of infection comes from the lead. If you are shot with a lead ball and you get blood poisoning from that lead ball, you're gonna get gangrene, tetanus. So your extremities were expendable. If you were hit in the torso or anywhere in the head and it didn't kill you instantly, they did the best they could to make you comfortable, but you were probably going to die.
Okay, so I'd recommend folks look up on Wikipedia or whatever, the Battle of Front Royal, which was May 23rd, 1862.
And also, if I might say, the Shenandoah Valley Battlefields Foundation.
Shenandoah Valley Battlefields Foundation.
And the Warren Heritage Society website.
That's what I was going to ask you. Yes. If folks want that, how do they get that information?
It's warrenheritagesociety.org. It's all one word. The Shenandoah Valley Battlefields Foundation has an excellent write-up about the battle and also about all of the other battles in the Valley Campaign. The Valley Campaign of 1862, Jackson's Valley Campaign, Front Royal was one battle of six that took place in his campaign. So this is an important battle by itself and had an incredible impact on this community. However, it's part of a larger campaign, and to understand that, the Battlefields Foundation website is the best source.
This is the first time you've said that, all this stuff. Awesome. Patrick Ferris, you're always a fascinating guy. Thank you
so
much.
As are you, Dan. Thank you.
Thank you.